I thought I'd go ahead and get started. And what I'd like to talk about today is really the changing paradigms in testosterone therapy. And these are my disclosures. I do consult for several companies that do make testosterone products. So what are the changing paradigms? What are the four big things you should know about with testosterone therapy? One is that the orals have now launched. There are new orals on the way that have come out for testosterone. The second is, what do we know about testosterone COVID?
There's some interesting findings, whether it's helpful or beneficial in patients who have COVID. The new changing paradigm on testosterone and prostate cancer. We've made a long way in the past 20 years on the way we think about testosterone, and could it be potentially therapeutic or beneficial for men with prostate cancer? And finally, this concept of lifestyle modification I'd like to go into. So let's go ahead and get started. So if you think about the true sense of oral testosterone, it really was thousands of years ago, where the ancient Indians and Egyptians used to eat testicular tissue for the medicinal benefits of testosterone, reporting improvements in impotence and well-being. But it really wasn't till 1935 when Boudinot and Ruzicka first did the chemical synthesis of testosterone. And actually in 1935 is when the first oral testosterone was made. And remember that this was a 17-alpha methylated testosterone. And the reason why they had to do a 17-alpha methylation was because if they didn't, it would be degraded by the liver. So they remember that the oral testosterones would pass by the liver and they were degraded by the liver, and this 17-alpha configuration protected against degradation. The problem was is that this also increased hepatotoxicity. So patients who took oral testosterone had an increased risk of hepatotoxicity and liver cancers as well. But something interesting happened in the 1970s. We were able to synthesize testosterone undecanoate, which is an oral formulation that came out. And the difference with this formulation is that it doesn't pass by through the liver. It avoids first pass metabolism by the liver, and it's absorbed by the lymphatics. Some of the negatives is that this medication has to be taken with food, fatty meals, in order to get absorbed through the lymphatics as well. And because of the short half-life, you have to take it multiple times a day, and there were variable serum testosterone levels when you took this medication. So this is just a schematic demonstrating that when you take the oral testosterone through the intestines, it bypasses the liver and it goes back into the lymphatic system and then into the bloodstream. So this really revolutionized oral testosterone. But the first oral testosterone was called Androyl Testocaps. And Androyl Testocaps, next year will be 45 years that's been in the market, but it was never approved in the United States. So it's approved in Asia, in Europe, but the U.S. never approved Androyl Testocaps. Some of the problems with this original formulation was that it had to be refrigerated, it had a very short half-life, and it wasn't until 2003 where they changed the formulation. Instead of using oleic acid, they used castor oil, which allowed it to be not refrigerated, and you could have a three-year shelf life. But it never really made it gain favor in the United States. And it's not FDA approved in the United States. So this is looking at the concept of fatty foods, because patients will say, you know, I'm taking testosterone to lose weight, and you're telling me that I got to take this three times a day with a fatty meal, right? It doesn't make sense, but that's what it was. And if you took the Androyl Testocaps without a fatty meal fasting, you essentially get no absorption. Right, so you have to take it with at least 23 grams of fat or lipids inside the meal to get the absorption. But the good news is that there was no liver toxicity, and there's no hepatotoxicity even up to 10 years out when you're taking these oral formulations. But the first oral that's undecanoate in the United States was released in March of 2019. And so now we have this available. It's called Jitenzo, and it is available to patients today. And Jitenzo comes in 237 milligram capsules. You give twice, two of these as a starting dose, and it can be adjusted up or down accordingly. So, but this is a BID dosing. It's not a TID dosing. It's a BID dosing. And this is some of the PK data looking at the BID dosing. And as you can see, it gives very good levels. It gives very good levels, and then the patients will take it again the second time during the day. And what's beneficial about Jotenzo is it really doesn't depend on a high fatty meal. It can actually be a low fatty meal, moderate fatty meal, but you don't have to have a high fatty meal. It just has to be a meal, right? So that is one of the benefits of this Jotenzo. The FDA did ask that these new testosterone formulations undergo hypertension studies. And so you should be aware that there is a slight increase in blood pressure. In the Jotenzo trial, it was 5 millimeters of mercury systolic, roughly 2.5 millimeters diastolic. And the take-home message is that roughly 7% of patients who start these oral formulations will either have to increase their hypertensive medication or just start hypertensive medication, antihypertensive medication. So again, you do want to monitor blood pressure in patients who take Jotenzo, and it's in the black box warning as well, 7% of patients. But what's interesting is that the rate of erythrocytosis goes down. So remember this, when patients take testosterone, they can develop erythrocytosis. The highest risk is in patients who are on injectables. The erythrocytosis rate can be up to 66% on injectables. And we know that that rate drops all the way down anywhere from 8 to 12% on transdermals. So if someone is taking an injectable, they start developing erythrocytosis, one of the easiest things you can do is switch them to a topical. But the orals tend to have even lower rates of erythrocytosis. And this was roughly about 5% in this trial had erythrocytosis in this trial. We still do see an increase in estradiol and DHT, a slight increase. So remember that we monitor estradiol in our practice, also DHT, because remember that 0.3% of testosterone is converted into estrogen, right? And roughly 6% of testosterone is converted into dihydrotestosterone. So again, we do see these increases as well. And you should also be aware that there is a new oral testosterone coming out on the market. The FDA has approved a tentative approval for Tylando, which will be the second testosterone decanoate next year in 2022. So right now we have Jotenzo, next year we'll have Tylando, and you should just be aware that the oral testosterone market tends to be growing. I think patients in the U.S. are very comfortable taking pills. They take pills for many other reasons, and it's very simple. But the only key point is that it's a BID dosing. So sometimes when you have BID dosing, that decreases the compliance. But again, something to be on the lookout for. The second topic I'd like to talk about is COVID and testosterone. So earlier studies in 2020 when the pandemic started showed that men were much more severely affected than women. In fact, the studies demonstrated that men were 3 times more likely to die from COVID than women. And the theory was that could this be related to higher testosterone levels in men? So we published an article this year on testosterone and COVID, and what we found was that testosterone does play a clear role in modulating the immune response and inflammation. And I want to share this with you because it's important. It can actually decrease the immune response, but it can also decrease inflammation. But testosterone levels were inversely correlated with the severity of COVID symptoms. In other words, if a man has COVID right now and he has a low testosterone level, much more likely to have severe symptoms, meaning being in the ICU, mortality. But there's this paradoxical effect that I want to explain today. Low serum testosterone levels may be protective against developing COVID. There is some conflicting data. However, low serum testosterone levels have been associated with worse clinical outcomes, including mortality, in those infected with COVID. How I want you to think about it is this. Think about a man who currently does not have COVID, and think of a man who currently does have COVID. In men who currently do not have COVID, having lower testosterone levels may be protective. In a man who currently has COVID, low testosterone levels may result in more severe outcomes. And I want to show you the data on this. We call this the paradoxical effect. So testosterone has been shown to decrease the immune response. Testosterone suppresses antibody response to infection, suppresses inflammatory immune cells, and also can dampen the development and function of T and beta cells, which help our immune system. And could this increase the susceptibility of developing COVID? The second is that testosterone decreases the inflammation. So remember, why do patients with COVID get sick? It's the cytokine release, right? It's a severe increase in cytokines, which then put them in the ICU, ARDS. So, but testosterone has been shown to decrease inflammation. In other words, it can decrease pro-inflammatory markers, and it can also increase anti-inflammatory markers. And could this decrease cytokine storm, decrease severe symptoms, and decrease mortality? So a very interesting finding. But it actually gets even more interesting. So we know that circulating androgens bind to the androgen receptor, which promote the transcription of TMPRSS. The TMPRSS protein is very important. Because what the TMPRSS protein does, the COVID spike proteins are primed by the TMPRSS protein. And this allows them to react with the ACE2 receptor and then get into the cell. So essentially what you're seeing here is that androgens indirectly help the COVID virus into the cell by actually promoting transcription of the TMPRSS protein. So some studies have shown that androgen deprivation therapy has been shown to lower the TMPRSS expression and theoretically protect you from getting the virus. So let's look at some of the studies. This is the first study that got a lot of attention. This study was a study looking at androgen deprivation therapy in prostate cancer patients from an Italian database. The prostate cancer patients on androgen deprivation therapy had lower rates of COVID-19 infection than prostate cancer patients not on androgen deprivation therapy. In fact, the odds ratio was a little over 4. Now, there's been some conflicting data. A study came out more recently by Dr. Klein's group, looking at almost 1,800 men, found that there was no protective role with androgen deprivation therapy from COVID infection. So again, there's conflicting data, but you should be aware that there's data on both sides. What I do find interesting is that there are several clinical trials looking at medications to decrease testosterone to help protect patients from the virus. There's two clinical trials using androgen deprivation therapy in critically ill hospitalized patients with COVID-19. One is the Degarelix trial, and the other one is the enzalutamide trial. And then there are other trials, dutasteride trial in patients with COVID-19 infection, not hospitalized. These are all three clinical trials that are currently underway. Now, I talked about the second patient, the patient that actually has COVID, and you look at his testosterone level. Lower baseline testosterone levels have been shown to predict poor prognosis and mortality in COVID patients in the ICU. Other studies have shown that total testosterone levels were significantly lower in ARDS patients compared with patients without ARDS. And finally, men with testosterone levels less than 100, so significantly low testosterone levels, had an 8-fold increase in hospital mortality compared to men with normal testosterone levels. So again, a very interesting finding. We also know that COVID affects the testicles directly in two ways. The first is we know that when patients who are affected with COVID will have a decrease in serum testosterone levels. This is a trial looking at 221 hospitalized men with COVID. Serum testosterone levels significantly decreased from pre-COVID levels of roughly 458 nanogram per deciliter to 315 nanogram per deciliter. And other interesting findings looking at patients with COVID, this study found that roughly 22% of patients had acute orchitis, epididymitis, or epididymorchitis on scrotal ultrasound imaging, and the incidence went up to almost 53% if the patients were older. So maybe some direct effect of COVID on testicular tissue. There have been studies looking at testicular tissue in men who have active COVID and who had COVID in the past, and you can still see the virus present many months after the patient has had COVID inside the testicular tissue. Now, I just want to make sure that we're not confusing cause with association, because these are, to me, associations. I can't tell you that low testosterone causes increased severe symptoms and having testosterone will be protective, because you have to look at these two populations. If you look at the risk factors for patients who are hypogonadal, they're exactly the same risk factors for those patients who are suffering from severely ill COVID symptoms. For example, obesity, hypertension, dyslipidemia, hyperglycemia, insulin resistance. These are the same risk factors. So maybe it's just the fact that they share the same risk factors that these patients are suffering from more severe symptoms and not testosterone at all, right? So it's very important that we don't associate cause with association at this point. The next big topic is testosterone and prostate cancer. So this was a survey that came out in 2006, and they asked clinicians, what is your number one concern with testosterone? And they said, I'm going to give this patient prostate cancer. I mean, every country you talk to at that time, clinicians were concerned, we're going to give this patient prostate cancer. So we went, when I was a resident, from this concept that testosterone is dangerous. This was about 15 years ago. Then maybe it's potentially safe. And now this paradigm shift that may be therapeutic or protective. And I want to share with you some of the data on this. One thing that has really changed the way we look at testosterone and prostate cancer is this concept of the saturation model. And remember that we were taught in medical school that the greater the testosterone, the greater the PSA, and the greater the risk for prostate cancer. We were taught that this line was linear. You see testosterone here on the x-axis, you see prostate growth and PSA on the y-axis. But we know that that's not true. We know that at some point the prostate saturates. So if a man comes in today with a testosterone level, say, of 300, and I take him to 3,000, we don't really see a change in PSA or prostate growth. But all of us in this room know that if I give that exact same patient Lupron and I bring that testosterone all the way down, the PSA will come down. So the prostate saturates. There's some debate on what the saturation point is. I personally believe it's between 200 and 250. Some people believe it's a little bit lower. But why is this important? Because if a patient comes in to me and his testosterone is 200 and his PSA, say, is 5, and I put that patient on testosterone supplementation, he's going to see a change in his PSA. He's below the saturation point, right? If the patient comes in at testosterone of 300 and I put him on testosterone, he shouldn't see much change in the PSA at all, right? So that's a really important point before you start someone on testosterone therapy to know where that testosterone is and how much of a PSA rise you should see. We published a paper showing that on average you see about 0.3 nanogram per deciliter. 0.3. So if a patient comes in, he's a PSA of 0.5, I put him on testosterone, he goes to 0.8, I'm not concerned, particularly if his PSA was low, right? Where this gets really tricky is where you have patients who have had XRT and androgen deprivation therapy, and they come into you with a testosterone of 80, and they want you to start them on therapy. Well, what's going to happen is you start them on therapy and that PSA is going to rise and everyone's going to get nervous, right? Because that's exactly what's supposed to happen. But if you believe in the prostate saturation model, it should plateau and that PSA should plateau at some point, which typically it does. But again, it's something to keep in mind on patients on androgen deprivation therapy who you're going to start on TRT and their Ts are low, it's going to change. It's going to go up, you know? So I just wanted to start with this story. 2003, I was a resident. I was sitting in Grand Rounds, and I was Journal Club, excuse me, and this article came out of giving testosterone to men with high-grade PIN. And the urologic oncologist that was sitting next to me in Journal Club said, could you believe that Dr. Morgenthaler is giving men testosterone with high-grade PIN? Doesn't he know that it's going to cause prostate cancer? This was in 2003. And this study showed that there was no significant increase in prostate cancer in men with high-grade PIN. But the point is, in 2003, we were pretty concerned. We thought this was kind of crazy, giving men testosterone with high-grade PIN. There have been numerous studies giving men testosterone after radical prostatectomy, but the paradigm change started roughly around 2015 when Dr. Denmead's group out of Hopkins started giving men high doses of testosterone for metastatic prostate cancer. So that's how he treats them. So this was the first study, 14 patients with castrate-resistant prostate cancer. He gave them testosterone 400 milligrams IM every month for 3 months. At the same time, he gave them Lupron. So what you would see is a very high increase in testosterone, and then it would bottom out. It's called bipolar androgen therapy. High doses of T, then it would bottom out. And what did he find? He found a 50% reduction in PSA, 50% reduction in PSA, and a 50% reduction in metastatic disease on scanning. This is unheard of, that we would have never done this 10 years ago, but this is what they started doing in 2015. His follow-up study was 29 asymptomatic hormone-sensitive patients with prostate cancer. They either had to have low-burden metastatic disease or just a biochemical recurrence. Again, 6 months of BAT therapy is what he did. Of androgen deprivation by 4 months, followed by 400 milligrams every 4 weeks for 3 months with high doses of testosterone. Almost 60% of those patients had a PSA less than 4 after 18 months, which was their endpoint. And what did you expect? These patients felt better. quality of life felt better, and their erections were better as well. This group has published many more studies. There have been many more studies, but the concept is the same. Giving men high doses of testosterone to treat metastatic prostate cancer. This came out just a couple months ago. This is by Abe Morgenthaler's group, giving 22 men treated with testosterone therapy with advanced prostate cancer. So 7 men had biochemical recurrence, 13 men had metastatic prostate cancer, 2 men adjuvant androgen deprivation therapy, and the median age was 70, right? Median duration was of testosterone therapy was 12 months. Overall mortality was 13.6%, and prostate cancer mortality was 4.5% during the period of testosterone therapy and 6 months after discontinuation. What was interesting is that 7 of the 10 with follow-up imaging within 12 months showed no progression. So again, you're giving these patients with metastatic disease testosterone with no progression. There were no cases of rapid onset or complications, no vertebral collapses. Patients reported improvements in their symptoms. And he concluded that, you know, these initial observations indicate that testosterone therapy was not associated with precipitous progression of prostate cancer in men with biochemical recurrence or metastasis, suggesting a possible role of testosterone therapy in selected men with advanced prostate cancer who want to improve their quality of life. It's just an interesting concept. It's just an interesting concept of giving these men testosterone with metastatic disease. I still think that, you know, we have a lot to learn. I still would be very cautious in doing this without being in a clinical trial. But I still think that, again, it's just a complete paradigm shift. We're not the first to do this. You know, in 1965, Huggins proposed that both hormonal deprivation and hormonal excess, which he termed hormonal interference, may be useful and therapeutic at that time. And even in the 1950s through the 1980s, there were case reports of reporting therapeutic benefit of giving testosterone therapy to men with advanced prostate cancer. So I'd like to just illustrate a point, because this is from our lab. We published this several years ago, where we take LNCAP cells or prostate cancer cells. We give different amounts of testosterone in the Petri dishes. And what you see is that as you start giving testosterone to these LNCAP cells, you definitely see a significant increase in prostate cancer cell growth. There's no question. But as you give higher and higher doses of testosterone, you actually see a suppression in prostate cancer cell growth. And we coined this term the inverted U, where castrate may be beneficial, and maybe normal or eugonadal levels are beneficial, but the hypogonadal range may be the danger zone, right? And we saw the same thing. This is LNCAP cells with no testosterone. You start giving testosterone to the LNCAP cells, they grow. At higher doses of testosterone, you see a suppression. So we said, well, if this happens in vitro, what happens in vivo? So we took almost 200 mice. They were either controls, orchiectomy plus low-dose testosterone, orchiectomy plus high-dose testosterone, and we injected LNCAP cells in the back of these rats. We followed them for almost 3 months. So this is the testosterone pellets we put underneath the skin. This is the prostate cancer growing on the back, and we measured the prostate cancer. And what did we find? We found almost the same thing we found in vivo. And what did we find was that if you look at prostate cancer incidence rates, castration definitely helps. It actually makes a big difference. But if you give low doses of testosterone, you start running into a problem. But if you give higher doses of testosterone, it actually suppresses prostate cancer cell growth. Again, showing the inverted U. So personally for me, if I had a history of radical prostatectomy and I was hypogonadal, I would say just give me either castrate me or put me in the normal range. But I think the hypogonadal range is definitely the danger zone. So just a couple of important, two more recent studies. This was by Stacey Loeb's group. It was a case-controlled study of National Prostate Cancer Registry of Sweden. 284 patients with prostate cancer. They had almost 1,400 case controls. These patients all started testosterone therapy. They found no association between testosterone therapy and overall prostate cancer risk. But what was interesting was that patients who received testosterone had lower risk of aggressive prostate cancer. And so the conclusion was decreased risk of aggressive prostate cancer with TRT is a novel finding that warrants further investigation. More recently, Dr. Allering's group looked at 850 patients undergoing radical prostatectomy, 152 low-risk patients with no evidence of disease started testosterone therapy for a mean of 3.5 years. Cancer had recurred in only approximately 7.2% of patients treated with testosterone, where cancer had recurred in almost 12.6% of patients who did not receive testosterone. Patients on TRT were 54% less likely to recur. So again, in men destined to recur, TRT delayed time to recurrence by 1.5 years. Now, we should just be aware of what the AUA guidelines say. The AUA guidelines are very clear, strong recommendation that clinicians should inform patients of the absence of linking testosterone therapy to prostate cancer. Strong recommendation. But the AUA guidelines also state that patients with testosterone deficiency and a history of prostate cancer should be informed there's inadequate evidence to quantify the risk-benefit ratio of testosterone therapy at this time. Be very clear, we don't have a large randomized placebo-controlled trial looking at this, but you should be aware of what the AUA guidelines say. And I want to end this section by putting this in here. This is I showed you a survey at the beginning of this talk in 2006, where there's a significant concern by providers, urologists, giving men testosterone for the fear of developing prostate cancer. And if you look at another survey 10 years later, two urologists asking them about testosterone and prostate cancer, 96% of urologists say that they would give testosterone to men after a radical prostatectomy, 96%. 84% would give them after radiation therapy, 86% after brachytherapy. But about a third of them would even offer testosterone to men on active surveillance, right? So I do think that the paradigm is shifting. I think that clinicians are becoming more comfortable giving testosterone to men with a history of prostate cancer, much more so than we saw 10 to 15 years ago. You should also be aware that there's a large trial called the TRAVERSE trial that's underway. This is a 6,000 participant trial, randomized placebo-controlled trial. Anticipated completion is June of 2022. I'm one of the investigators helping conduct this trial. The primary outcome, yes, is MACE, to look at cardiovascular events. But the secondary outcome we're looking at is incidence of high-grade prostate cancer. So this will be the largest trial ever looking at testosterone versus placebo, and we will be looking at prostate cancer as well. The last topic is really testosterone alternatives, and this was in the new 2020 guidelines as well. A patient walks in and he has hyperlipidemia, or he has hypertension, and you walk into your internist's office and you have a blood pressure that's elevated. We don't just start by giving you a blood pressure medication. We don't start by giving you a statin. The way we treat you is with lifestyle modification. We try to make changes so that you can actually improve the blood pressure or the lipids. Well, the same thing works with testosterone. There are things that you can do, lifestyle modification, that can significantly improve testosterone levels without having to take pills. Diet and exercise, weight loss, sleep, stress reduction, varicose repair. And I want to highlight some of these. Probably the best study I've ever seen was the Camacho study, which is from the Massachusetts Male Aging Study on obesity and testosterone. And there is a bidirectional relationship when it comes to testosterone and obesity. If a man loses 10% of his body weight, just 10% of his body weight, he can see almost a 85 nanogram per deciliter increase in serum testosterone. That's okay. It's not great, but it's okay. If he loses 15% of his body weight, he sees almost a 270 nanogram per deciliter increase in serum testosterone, which is significant. So the line is not linear, it's curvilinear, and so again, losing weight can significantly improve serum testosterone. But remember, it goes the other way. If you put on fat, if you gain weight, your serum testosterone will lose the same amount as well. It's proportional. So again, losing weight is very helpful. The problem is that many patients don't keep off the weight. In other words, they'll lose the weight, but then they'll start gaining the weight again. It's not sustainable. So there are studies looking at the bariatric literature, and they found the same thing. If you put patients on a low-calorie diet and they lose the body weight, it's about 10% improvement. They lose 10% versus 32% of their body weight. You see roughly an 85 nanogram per deciliter increase in serum testosterone, but bariatric surgery, 250 nanogram per deciliter increase in serum testosterone. So again, weight loss is very, very helpful in increasing T levels. Sleep is critical. It's extremely important in terms of serum testosterone levels. Remember that patients who have sleep apnea will have lower testosterone levels because we know that when the oxygen level decreases in the brain, you decrease the LH secretion from the pituitary, thus you decrease testosterone levels. So if you can increase the O2 content, you can actually improve serum testosterone. Studies have shown that surgically improving sleep apnea or giving patients a CPAP machine can actually improve serum testosterone levels. Very interesting. If you restrict sleep for 8 nights to just 5 hours a night, you will see about a 15% decrease in serum testosterone levels. But the important point is that the second half of the night is more important than the first half of the night. So if you actually maintain your sleep between 4 and 8 a.m., there was no significant change. So the second half of the night, as opposed to 12 to 4, it's the 4 to 8 time, which is more important than the first half of the night in maintaining serum testosterone values. Varicose oral repair has been shown to improve serum testosterone levels. Some studies have shown about 80 nanogram per deciliter. Other studies have shown about 100 nanogram per deciliter, improving serum testosterone as well. And so I just want you to get the point here. A patient with sleep apnea who's obese, who has a varicose, you start fixing the varicose and the sleep apnea and you start losing some weight, you're starting to get some real numbers in improvements in serum testosterone without giving that patient a pill or a drug that they have to be dependent on. So just a thought that lifestyle modification may be very effective. So in conclusion, oral testosterone therapy appears to be effective and safe with minimal increase in hematocrit and blood pressure and no hepatotoxicity. Normal levels of testosterone may increase viral entry while paradoxically providing a relatively protection from the hyperreactive immune state that drives COVID mortality. COVID-19 can directly affect testicular tissue and decrease serum testosterone levels. There may be a therapeutic and/or protective role of testosterone therapy against prostate cancer, and lifestyle modification can significantly affect serum testosterone levels. Thank you for your attention, and if you have any questions or comments, please feel free to email me at any time. Thank you.